Okay, we're going to talk about angular momentum. So just as an object can have linear and angular kinetic energy, it can have linear and angular momentum. So the linear momentum, and now we have the angular momentum. Again, it comes from a Latin word, so it's an L. But look at the parallel here. The linear momentum was mass times velocity, and here instead of mass, we have the moment of inertia. Instead of linear velocity, we have angular velocity. So a lot of parallels here between the angular or rotational material and the linear material. In this equation, I is the moment of inertia. Now, of course, that depends on a rotation axis, so let's add that A in there. So this is the moment of inertia, and omega is the angular speed. For units, we do not introduce a new unit. We use what's here. And these units come out to be kilogram, meter squared, divided by seconds squared. So we're going to do a lot of the same things for angular momentum that we did with linear momentum. So the first thing we did, or one of the things we did with linear momentum, was to rewrite Newton's second law. So we had, originally, the net force is equal to mass times acceleration, but then we wrote that in terms of momentum. So now the net force is the change in linear momentum over the time. So we're going to do the same thing here. So this is the angular version of the second law, which is the net force is equal to I alpha. Looks very similar to the linear version. And if we rewrite that, it comes out to be this. The net torque is equal to the change in angular momentum over the time. So again, it's very close parallel to the linear stuff. So there's our new equation written in terms of angular momentum. And then we're going to come up with the conservation of angular momentum, just like we had the conservation of linear momentum. So before we decided, after a little logic, that the conservation of linear momentum, okay, so we decided that linear momentum was conserved. So we wrote that this way. The net initial linear momentum is equal to the net final momentum. So by similar logic, we're just going to write down that we have a conservation of angular momentum, and that's that the net initial angular momentum is equal to the net final angular momentum. Okay, so this is the conservation of angular momentum. When we did this with the linear stuff, we were assuming there were no external forces. And that's generally a good assumption because the collision forces were typically very large. And so we either didn't have an external force, or if we did, it was very small. So we're going to make the same basic assumption here. So this assumes no external torques. So we continue on with the parallel of what we did with the linear momentum. So from the conservation of linear momentum, we came up with the equation we actually use or apply in all of our problems. M1V1 plus M2V2 initially equals M1V1 plus M2V2. Okay, so now we're going to basically do the same thing for angular momentum. And let me do that on the next page. So from the conservation of angular momentum, we now get, instead of MV, it's I omega for object 1 plus I omega for object 2. That's the initial. And that's equal to I omega 1 plus I omega 2 final. So pretty much exactly what we got before, but with the angular variables. Now, one thing that can happen in this scenario that couldn't happen in the previous scenario is this, that I can just have a single object and do something interesting where I can have changes with I and omega for just a single object all by itself. And that couldn't really happen when we were dealing with linear momentum. So in other words, if I had a single object before, and I tried to say that mv for that object initially is equal to mv for that object finally, well, there's nothing interesting about that because my mass is not going to change. There's no change in the mass. And if there's no change in the mass, then there's no change, so therefore no change in the velocity. So all this statement really says is the object just goes along with the same velocity forever until some external force acts on it, which is in fact Newton's first law anyway. So there's nothing interesting there. But this is not the case with rotational or angular momentum, because what we can do is not change the mass but rearrange it in the object. So I can actually change. And if I changes, that means omega has to change to compensate. And so this is actually what happens with a skater. When the skater is spinning around, the skater, ice skater, might bring her arms in or stretch her arms out, and then that changes her speed. Okay, so as we go forward, we'll see how that happens. Okay, so I've drawn down here a skater with her arms spread out, and then the skater with her arms pulled in. So the idea here is with the arms spread out, that gives the skater a big moment of inertia. And then when she pulls her arms in, she gets a smaller moment of inertia. But the total angular momentum, L, needs to be conserved. So therefore, if we have a big I, we must have a small omega. If we have a smaller I, we must get a larger omega, so that L is constant. So L initial and L final can remain the same. Okay, so that's the idea. And if we actually are giving numbers to solve an equation, then we'll go back. This is a single object, the person, and we're just changing I, and then we see how omega changes as a result. And then if I have two objects, then I'll go to the equation up here and apply that, just as we did in the collision and recoil problems. Okay, so that's the basic setup for angular momentum and the conservation of angular momentum.